let's do it lah. Yeah. 1, 2, 3, action. Yeah, what is up guys? Farhan here with Zah once again, and today we have Tony. How are you?
Hello, hi, nice to meet you.
Thank you so much for coming out and doing this bike with us. Apologize if the noise is drowned out because it's raining. So it's also very dark. Yeah, so this is Tony's bike, the Yamaha FJR1300 A, is it?
A, yeah, A.
Is it, what does the A stand for?
Yeah, actually I'm not sure because this model, right, in the global market, there's two models, A and ES. So ES is electronic suspension. A, I don't know, is it? A is not electronic, it's more of like maybe it's adjustable because the suspension can adjust one. The rear shock, actually there's only two settings, hard and soft.
But the
electronic one is like you can press button a lot, hard, soft, then a lot of settings.
Not api api.
This one is like api api, but then you know to keep up with like all the newer bikes, more electronics, then they come out with the ES model. But somehow Hong Leong never bring this model in.
Okay, so before Tony actually tell us the story about his FJR, I'm gonna give a bit of background about it.
A successor to the Yamaha FJ1200, the Yamaha FJR1300 is a sports touring motorcycle in production since 2001. The FJR is directly competing with Honda's ST series and the BMW RT series of sports tourers. It is a popular police motorcycle in some European police forces. Tony's model is the third generation of Yamaha FJR1300. Engine is a 1298cc transverse inline 4 liquid cooled UHC, 4 valves per cylinder, with electronic fuel injection and a 6-speed manual transmission. In Singapore, the Yamaha FJR is an uncommon sight on the streets.
Alright guys, so shout out to our sponsor, Liqui Moly.
Do check out their online store for awesome motorbike care related products.
Support us by clicking on the link below to view the range of products.
Or use our promo code upon checking out.
So Tony, this bike, I understand that it's actually second hand.
Yeah, second hand.
Yeah, that time when you got it, how much was it and how long did you ride it for?
Okay, when I got it back 2 years ago, the market price was around like 28,000 to 29,000.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, but I got it at a more special price lah. Yeah, so brand new that time, I think it was around 39,000 to 40,000 like that, with COE lah.
Okay.
Yeah, so quite tall lah the price. Yeah.
So you're owner number what?
I'm actually owner number 3.
Okay.
The first owner is like uncle. That buy the bike from the shop. Then after he passed down to his son. Then the son, I think, ride a while, then he cannot tahan.
Yes. So long.
This bike is not for everybody.
Yeah, not for everybody.
And like you say, just now your first owner is an Ape, right?
Yeah.
And this bike has a reputation for being an Ape bike. And it's true lah. I mean, when you see an FJR, it's usually an old guy riding it.
More senior rider.
So don't want to say Ape bike lah. Veteran.
Veteran.
Get offended. For yourself, why the FJR?
Okay, just maybe a bit of story lah. Because I used to ride Super 4 Spec 3. Now that when I passed my Class 2 license, then I thought, so same lah, I got a riding group last time, then they all got Class 2 bike. So you know lah, they poisoned me, then after they say, wow, Class 2 very different level lah, the power. So they say, why not just get the Class 2? So actually my first Class 2 bike is not this, it's actually the Honda Blackbird.
That's a legend.
Yeah. So, but actually I didn't know the Blackbird's like status at the time. I just saw the bike like, okay lah, look like a sport bike. Because last time I young, I want to ride sport bike, but I cannot tahan the comfort, the posture and aggressive lah. So then I look, but I like the fairing, like the sports bike fairing, the full fairing look lah. I saw this bike on Carousel, it's a Blackbird, then I thought, oh, okay lah, like looks decent and the price also quite cheap lah. So okay, I just try first, I buy one, then ride there, ride already lah. The feel is like there lah. Yeah, but of course the Blackbird live a very short life lah, because you know Singapore, the roads sometimes got the pothole and all. Then after that, when people feedback to LTA, right, then they patch up the hole. Sometimes the hump is not flat, so a lot of this kind of like bump. So there was one time I was turning from KJE to BKE.
Okay.
Yeah, then I think I go over quite a tall hump. It's like at quite a 90 km per hour because expressway mah. Yeah. So and because Blackbird is the suspension is actually quite hard. So I go over the bump, the chassis and the thing broke. dislodged and boom on the road there.
Eh. Oh, shit lah. Then, yeah. Accident?
Thankfully, no accident. It's like the, oh. Okay, so you imagine the main stand. Like main stand, the whole thing just dropped on the road.
Pull.
Then the whole thing dragged, like the bike and the thing dragged on the road. Yeah, so when after the thing happened, I called for tow lah. Then after that, when the tow guy come up, we tried to load up the vehicle, also cannot because it's like you have to push the bike, drag the bike from the road. It's not like tire, you push up the bike. Usually just now we push the bike also like quite strong. This side is drag the road. I drag on the road.
Oh,
yeah. So it's like I only rode the Blackbird for like 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
Then wow, it's like total loss lah. When we sent to the workshop, the boss see already. Okay, just scrape this bike because cannot save already.
Cannot save already.
Yeah, because even if you save, right, like safety lah, is in the bike will never be the same as because they weld back. It's not as
100%.
Yeah. So it's like safety. Don't sabo the next owner. Just scrape it lah.
Yeah lah. True.
Yeah. Then after that, it's like I felt the void. Like alamak, I never ride long enough. Then. Yeah, I thought it's like okay lah. Then after that, I rode a scooter, Maxim 400, SYM Maxim 400. Yeah, then I ride a bit no power mah, because just two suddenly drop to 2A scooter. Like wow, I twist specs already, also cannot move. So it's like okay lah. Then I just time to go back to fulfill the aspiration. Yeah, because a lot of people say that when you ride bike eventually, you want to be a true rider, like bucket list. You must ride a class 2 once in your life. You ride already, after that you want to downgrade or you want to do other things. At least you ride before lah. I look around Carousel, then I saw this FJR, like the price quite competitive, then the looks like okay, quite. Then I went down to see already, I look like I poisoned myself lah. Impulse bike, a bit of impulse lah, but that is what bike is all about. You see already, you like the bike you know lah, the gut feeling is that you just hood the bike. Yeah.
note to self, must get class 2 bike before I die.
License.
Must get 2 license. Must get class 2 bike.
And ride the bike.
And ride the bike to Thailand.
Yeah.
So, how would you describe its performance? The torque, the acceleration, the maneuverability, the handling.
Wow, this bike actually. Despite its size, basically because this bike with fuel, it weighs around 292 kg.
Mm-hmm.
So it's even heavier than the Hayabusa. Yeah, so of course like during car park, those kind of like slow stop and go, you can feel the weight. But once you pick up speed, and especially this bike excels in expressway because it's a sports tourer, so that is where it is at home, like truly at home. Expressway it is like almost as nimble like as you can. Like turn left, right, flip around, very easy as like a class 2A or even a 2B bike. Yeah, and of course in terms of like acceleration, this one, a lot of people see, because you see on the roads like FJR rider, they ride the older generation. Yeah, so it's like mostly those senior riders, they don't like to like open throttle too much, they ride very slow. Even those 2A riders ride faster than them.
Yeah. I can attest to that.
Yeah, so but to them it's like they know the comfort and the road presence of this bike. But once you open the throttle, it's actually a rocket.
Given that it's heavy, it's bulky, right? In Singapore, you don't really face the highway that much. Mostly in a minor road, especially. There's lots of traffic and all that. Do you think it's cumbersome for you or not?
You know certain roads in Singapore very notorious for jams. TP exit, the kind of jam. You know the car zigzag, that kind. This kind of jam is cannot. But if it's normal expressway, like heavy traffic, maybe CTE, very common CTE, that kind of jam. Still manageable, still can in between. Of course, in terms of the pickup and the acceleration, it's like very smooth because FJR is known to be a very smooth engine. Yeah, the engine actually never changed for 20 years, you know, like other models are change a bit engine, increase the
displacement. Every generation, every new version, they tweak the engine.
Like Ducati from the Maltese Prada, 1002, they tweak to 1260cc. This one is standard. From day one it launched until now, the engine is the same. So it goes to show if it is working, you don't fix it. a lot of people like to test, like the manufacturers, they like to challenge, test water, then test already, a lot of problems come out.
So from stop to accelerate, is it draggy? Can you
Yeah, okay, so this bike, right, because it's a sports tour, so the RPM actually is very low. Okay, mm-hmm. Because this one, the maximum RPM is like only 8,500. Compared to Super 4, like Super 4 is like 13,500. So it's like Super 4, you need to like whack until the rev go up until like very high. This one, most of the time, it's like you are only traveling between 3,000 to 4,000 RPM. So it's like almost like car, that kind of. RPM so feel almost no vibration.
Okay.
It's like no vibration. The only thing you can feel from the throttle is like the feedback from the road, like the bumps, or you can feel it through your. It is that smooth that you can feel it through the. Ride two feet, but vibration a lot.
Yeah,
you,
yes.
The after riding for a long time, your hand will get numb. This one you ride 2 hours, the hand also won't get numb.
Oh, so the vibration is very minimal.
Yeah, this one is almost no vibration. Almost no hand. Yeah. So
I must really applaud the engineering team.
For 20 years late, like no change. And it's like when this FJR first launched back in 2001, right? It's like ahead of its time already. You know, some bikes they come out, it's like 2001, like all the api-api technology, the engine very rugged, very sluggish. This one is like, wow, come out, it's like already ahead of its time, like 10 years ahead of its time already.
Okay. And then considering that this bike doesn't use a chain, and then it uses a shaft, right?
Yeah, shaft.
So that actually, you know, add on to the comfort feeling.
Because actually for shaft drive, it's actually the smoothest, like got three drive chain, belt and shaft. Shaft drive, the transmission is actually the smoothest of all the three. Like chain, sometimes your chain, like the tension never make properly, then you can feel that, the metal grinding. This one don't have. Yeah, so shaft is like, and some Yamaha, because there's different bikes also with shaft, the more famous one is like the GS 1002 also shaft, and the GTR, the GTR also shaft, right? But BMW, the shaft, I got talked to some BMW owners before, they say the shaft, after like 5 years down and beyond, right, there's a tendency that the shaft would like some got problem, they have to change the whole shaft, which I think is like around 4,000, 5,000, very expensive.
There's a downside if the shaft got issue or problem.
If the shaft got issue, but so Yamaha, right, their shaft is like one of the most like reliable and bulletproof. Online reviews, they say that they have ride this bike because this bike around for 20 years already. They ride for like over 150,000 km, 200,000 km, the kind of mileage. The shaft is still like okay. Working. So they say the Yamaha engineers also got say that this bike, right, the shaft is designed to last the bike's lifetime. Unless you drop like those kind of Malaysia, those super big pothole, you go inside. Of course, don't say lah.
Yeah la.
Normal road condition, the shaft can basically last the entire bike's lifetime.
That's cool. That's very, very reassuring to know, you know.
So being a sport tourer of the current 2020s era, I'm sure it has the relevant technology, such as stability control, ABS and all that, right?
Yeah, okay. So actually this bike, right, compared to its competition, like because this bike actually, in terms of its class, the competition only that few bikes only. Like from BMW is the RT 1200, now it's 1250 lah. Because GS, that one is more of like adventure touring, so different category. Then from Kawasaki is the GTR 1004 lah. Then Honda used to be the ST 1100, then become ST 1300. Suzuki actually don't have a proper one. Because actually a lot of people, right, they say that Hayabusa is a sports tourer. But I got right before Hayabusa and the Kawasaki ZS40R lah. I feel that they are leaning more towards the sports bike kind of performance. This one is actually more towards the sports touring, because if you want to see what is a sports tourer, right, of course the posture and the comfort. Hayabusa people ride 2-3 hours, actually can feel that the wrist is tired, the back a bit problem.
Yeah.
Of course the windshield is like unique, you need to tuck down under the windshield. This one sit upright, and of course in terms of the top speed, it's actually not meant to whack, because Hayabusa I think can whack 300 km per hour. This one, the top speed only 260 only. And this one got all the creature comforts like cruise control. Hayabusa don't have. Hayabusa ZS14 all don't have cruise control. But the RT 1002 have cruise control. GTR also have cruise control. Electronics wise, actually very simple lah. It only has ABS and traction control. Basically that's it. they don't have like, you know, the
BMW
that kind of what lean sensitive ABS all the, actually that one overkill la. Too many electronics. You're not MotoGP in Singapore, you know, that kind of to me, I feel that traction control and ABS is the just nice. Like just nice enough for.
Or maybe perhaps because Singapore is too small for us to actually utilize this technology.
This technology, you know? Correct. Yeah.
No, so unless you are living in the US, whereby you know, it's such a big country, you can travel interstate.
Yeah.
That would be more fun. You can actually feel that technology. But because Singapore is so small, you go to work, Tampines, Boleh, Pasir Ris, Jurong, Pasir Ris, Tuas. That's
it. Correct. Yeah. So this one, right? The windshield, you can adjust electronically. Right? You use the button, you press, then the windshield come up, then come down. Yeah. Then actually, basically, that's it. So not much electronics. Yeah. Which is a good thing, because more electronics means the cost is higher.
Yep.
The
bike more
also,
headache.
Also, more headache, maintenance. Then breakdown also easier, lah. This one, so far, no issues, lah.
Let's talk about the storage space for the FJR. Mm. So these side boxes, they are stock, is it?
Yeah. It actually comes with the FJR as like a standard, lah. That means. The manufacturer, when they sell this bike, it comes together with the panniers.
Oh.
So the panniers are actually quite large. Even though I think it's like 32 liters, should be 32 or 34 liters, I can't remember. But it can actually fit two full face helmets. Like one on each side. Yeah, it can fit.
Seriously?
One each.
Can fit. Yeah, then of course, in terms of like accessories, right, it can come with the top box, but no point. I find that it's no point. You put already, then.
Ugly.
Yeah, okay, first it looks ugly. Second is they say that you affect the bike's stability because it's a safety overloaded. Behind is overloaded.
It also affects the aerodynamics.
Correct.
There's also some glove compartments in front here.
At the left side here, there's a compartment you can put your passport, your glove. Then inside there's a 12-volt USB socket to charge your phone.
It's not keyless.
This one is the traditional the key.
Traditional key.
Not like I think BMW and GTR, they use the keyless system.
You're right.
Yeah, this one is still the traditional turn the key.
Yeah, the GTR uses a kipas.
Kipas.
I don't know what
I remember kipas only. KIPASS. Kipas killer system.
Let's talk about the design. I like the way that the panniers and the design actually integrate with the design of the bike. It really makes it seamless. And I see pictures without the panniers. It doesn't look nice.
Correct. Because when Yamaha, the engineers, when they design it, of course, they design the panniers to fit, to actually make the bike look like a sport tourer. Because when you remove the panniers, especially you look from the rear, because when you ride, people see from behind. Rider like to see you from behind. The bike look, in front, because you see, as the fuel tank very fat. The front also very fat. Suddenly, the fat become very thin behind. So it looks very weird. But with the panniels, it's like fat. Then it's just like fat. But at least the curves is like, you can see the curve is very, it is in line with the design of the bike.
Tony, what's your height?
My height is like 1.88.
So I think for yourself, you should be okay. Looking at the seat, it's also quite low.
This seat is actually quite low compact. I think this seat is in fact the same height as NC750.
For me, I'm tiptoeing slightly.
But this one, the thing is because it's a sports tourer and it's meant to tour, so the seat is actually very wide. So it's very comfortable when you sit on it. You don't feel that your backside very pain. You know, like some those normal like 2B bike, the seat very narrow. It's like almost like sitting on bicycle seat. Like, right long already, your backside very pain. This one, you ride 2 hours. No problem.
I see, I understand. Talking about riding far long distance, how big is the fuel tank and what is the, how far can you go on a full tank?
Okay, so this one, the fuel tank is 25 liters. With a 4.5 liter reserve, including. I do manual calculate. When I top up petrol, I calculate manually, then I look at the computer. On average, I'm getting around 18 km per liter to 20 km per liter, depending on how hard I twist. So it's actually quite fuel efficient for its class.
So slightly below 400 kilometers.
400 km I think is no problem. From Singapore to KL one shot, no need to top up.
So how's the maintenance like for the FJR? Is it on the high side given that it's a 1300cc?
A lot of people have the misconception that class 2 is like, wow, you buy class 2 means the money is throw into the black hole la. But this is partly true. Okay, so for maintenance wise, this one is actually quite standard for like as per other bikes like the normal oil change. This one actually without the oil filter is 3.8 liters. Mm-hmm. With oil filter is 4 liters. So you need to have 4 bottles la. Of course the oil filter, then spark plugs. Okay. One thing I noticed about a lot of riders in Singapore, right? They tend to change spark plug quite frequently la, which I feel that it is
unnecessary.
Yeah. Because spark plugs, right? Because all the Japanese the manufacturers, they design the spark plug to last like for 1 year, 2 years. If you count by mileage, it's about like 20,000 km to 25,000 km.
Yes.
But I see riders that 10,000 km they change already. So it's like wow.
I see riders every oil change tin.
Yeah.
Who's like, hey, siapa waste money?
Yeah.
$10 you can actually top up.
Correct.
Petrol,
yeah,
you know.
Correct. Yeah. Two B bike $10 because one cylinder mah. So one spark plug not so bad. But when you ride four cylinder bike, because this bike is four cylinder, so need four spark plug. Wow, it's times four leh. And this spark plug is not $10, it's $15. So 15 times 4 is $60. So it's like you are spending $60 for nothing.
For a full tank, you can get, you can pay for a full tank of petrol. Yeah,
yeah, precisely. Yeah. So that's why we need to raise more awareness. Actually, when you look at the service manual, they also got say that spark plug, they ask you to change spark plug every 20,000 km. So far, I've been following the manual, like every 20,000 change, never give me any problem. So that's why don't waste money unnecessarily.
Yeah, true. Yeah. For me, I make it a point, every 6 months. I change every 6 months.
okay. Yeah, because if let's say your daily mileage is not a lot, you don't ride the bike often, right? Also got problem.
Mm.
Because for me, I use this as the daily ride. So you ride the bike every day, got problem, got symptom come out, you will know one. Immediately you will know, then you will faster rectify it. Yeah, so this one standard spark plug, I change like every 20,000 km. Engine oil is maybe 5,000, even though manual say 10,000, but they save a bit, 5,000.
What about shaft oil?
Oh, shaft oil also change every 10,000 km. So it's like alternate oil change, two times oil change, then you change the shaft oil. Shaft oil actually quite cheap, like $20 to $30.
Mm. Where usually go to service the bike?
Oh, actually I go to this workshop called like Unique Motorsports. They are also a motorbike dealer, they also sell bikes. Why I go there is because they always got oil change promotion. You know, if you go to those like normal, the old school kind of workshop, right? Like one bottle, maybe it's like, depending on what kind of brand you change, can be from $22 to $30 per bottle. So imagine if you go to, you change those like $26 per bottle, four bottles is already like $100+. Plus oil filter is easily, each oil change, $120, $130. But I go to this workshop, their promotion is $85. So it's like, cheaper than last time I ride Super 4, right? I do oil change, oil filter, also 120. But this one $85. So it's like, wow, class 2, even cheaper than. So do things, as in, of course, must do your research. You hear from reviews, but you also must experience it yourself, then you will know like what to do, what not to do, also. And for this one, of course, air filter, I changed to the aftermarket. Canon air filter because I don't want every 20,000 keep changing the air filter. This one air filter every 10,000 to 20,000 km you just take out and wash $10, put back, and can keep using until the for the bike's lifetime. But of course for class 2, right, the only thing that is shown for class 2 is if a major component spoil, then that is where money start to go out. I ride for this bike for over 2 years already. The only major issue that this bike give me is the water pump spoil. That means your coolant and your engine oil will mix and come out is Milo. I changed the water pump around $700 plus just for the water pump. Of course, labor because class 2, especially for agile, is fairing. Remove the fairing, remove not a lot of workshop like to do class 2 bike because very troublesome, time consuming also.
How long was that downtime?
Water pump downtime was around 1.5 months. Okay, because they have to source for the parts. Okay, so one of the problems for the challenges for class 2 bike, right? Because generally in Singapore, not many people ride class 2 bikes. So workshops, they don't store spare parts. So every time got a major component spoil, must order overseas. So you order overseas, the shipping time, everything. Before COVID, very fast, like 1 to 2 months. now got COVID, you times two. So actually, my water pump, I was quite lucky that I can get it within 1.5 months. Normal time should be 3 months.
I see.
3 months, the bike in hospital cannot ride.
Is there a lot of accessories for the FJR, aftermarket parts and all that?
There's quite a few accessories. Because this bike has been around like for 20 years. The previous models I see, like those senior riders, like they ride the previous Gen 3 and Gen 2, they mod the exhaust, they change the grip, the seat and everything. But to me, I feel it's a bit waste money. Okay, because the accessories for FJR is not cheap. Not cheap. Because for me, as you can see, my bike, actually I got changed a few accessories. Because the previous owner, it came with the stock windshield and the stock seats.
Mm-hmm.
But a bit like got defect. The windshield got some kind of marking. I think, don't know what happened. So it's like, whenever I ride, I see got one thing like, there, I cannot take it. So I changed. And one thing for the FJR, the funny thing about the FJR is usually, like when you ride other bikes, right, the stock bike, the stock part will be usually cheaper than the accessory.
Uh-huh.
Usually, accessory more expensive. FJR is the other way around.
Huh?
The stock part is more expensive than the accessory. Really? Okay, for example, the windshield. If you go to auto machinery, auto machinery is the distributor for Yamaha stock parts. So you go to the rural road there, and the auto machinery is there. The stock windshield for this is $500. So very expensive. The aftermarket, the OEM one, because mine is the OEM FJR Tor windshield, is only 370. So it's like, I think already, why should I change stock when it costs more? But I change the OEM, especially it costs less.
Stock windshield $500?
Yeah.
Made of what, Sian? Crystal?
So that's the okay, but because maybe this because this bike is like manufactured in Japan. So you know Japanese.
Oh.
The moment you hear Japanese, need to pay more. But the build quality is there. You pay for what you get. Actually, when I took over this bike, it was quite modded. The previous owner mod this bike quite a lot. So actually, I spent effort to make it as stock as possible. So
under your care, you never add on anything extra lah.
Yeah, I only add on voltmeter, then the air filter I changed to Canon because I just want to wash. And of course it improved the performance a bit only lah. Then of course the windshield I changed because the previous one was a bit defective. If no defective, I'll just keep the windshield there. Then of course the seats, the scene for like torn. I think the cat went and scratched the seat. cat always like to scratch the seat.
Especially the seat very big to sit on it.
So when the bike come out, it's like already, it's already perfect, designed beautifully. Then when you go and mount it, it look ugly. Then you spend money to make it look ugly. So when you see a lot of FJR rider on the road, it's actually, most of their bikes is stock one. They don't change the exhaust because this bike is actually very quiet. Very quiet. So you change the exhaust, also cannot hear any difference. Not like sport bike. Change the exhaust, you can hear the difference. And the exhaust for this also not cheap. The stock exhaust per side, I think is, if I'm not mistaken, is 1,003. Because FJR got two exhausts.
Each 1,003.
Yeah, I think it's 1,003.
Each.
Yeah.
Wow.
Each.
Okay.
Not sure it's each or two is 1,003. Because this bike, the only approved aftermarket exhaust is Acra bike. I think, I don't know why lah, but maybe it's Euro 4. Because this bike is Euro 4. Euro 4 because of all the noise exhaust emission. You cannot make it into a full system. You can only put the slip on Acra bike. That one cost, before COVID, I remember it cost 1,009 plus GST. After COVID, it become 2,006. So it's like, okay, don't change. You change already, the bike also doesn't look nice.
Have you you brought this bike touring?
Actually, I only brought this bike to touring once, just nice before COVID happened. I went the furthest I went to Kruang. Go there, eat breakfast. Actually quite funny because I asked my neighbor, he's riding a Kawasaki ZS40R. One day, I say, very sian, just want to go up. You want to come or not? Okay, steady. The next day morning, go up. Then go up, he ride very fast, very hard to. This bike actually can keep up. But once he pass certain speed, over 200, start to have problem. So this bike, most comfortable is between 140 to 180. Because the wind also, after 160, the wind also unbearable.
So at that speed, does the bike vibrate a lot?
No, actually no, because this bike is, because you can see the wheel, the bike wheelbase is actually very long. So long is means very stable. And of course, this bike very heavy, 292 kg. So when you ride on Malaysia, 160, 180, very stable. Crosswind, all those won't affect.
So you does it, can you feel that you are actually speeding, I mean, at riding at high speed?
Actually, no. This one won't feel like, won't feel like. It's like you twist a bit, like, exit speed limit, must faster.
So at that speed, it's very stable and doesn't have a lot of vibrations.
Actually don't have, the handlebar doesn't shake, very smooth. That's why you ride this one shot up to Thailand also no problem, won't feel tired.
So you go to Kluang and then come back,
yeah.
Alamak, sayang lah.
Yeah, that's why sayang lah. This bike deserve to go more lah. Go more.
Don't worry, border open hopefully lah, Thailand.
Yeah, border hopefully.
So down the road, what is your long term plan?
Actually down the road, because me I very easy kena poison by
bike.
At first when I buy this bike, I think, okay lah, maybe I can ride this bike until COE script. Maybe ride for 5 years, 6 years. But I ride for 2 years, itchy already. Every time, that's why when you see like YouTube video or you see like Carousel, you see, you own self poison own self. Then you I want to try another bike. Because to me, life is about trying things. Then you will know which bike actually suit you more. Because actually I ride quite a lot of bikes already. I ride KTM Duke 200. That's my first bike lah. KTM Duke 200. Then I ride Phantom. Then I ride Super Force Factory. Then I ride Blackbird. Then I ride Maxim scooter. So it's like I ride all different kinds of like scooter, naked bike.
I see.
I never ride adventure bike yet lah. So maybe my next bike, I intend to let this go lah. Like to somebody that actually must ride this bike. Because this bike is actually quite the underrated legendary bike lah. People always like. Here was sport bike Hayabusa, that kind of. Actually, sport tourer is the one that is sustainable lah. Because when you ride Busa, you ride fast you feel that actually very sian. You can only fast then after that very tight, very sian. But this one is sustainable, fun and yet very very comfortable. Even you daily commute this in Singapore, no problem. That's why you see a lot of senior riders. They ride the older generation FJR, right? They just ride to work, pilen their spouse, no problem.
So who would you recommend the FJR for?
Okay, I would recommend of course for people who want to experience like road presence. Okay, because when I ride this on the road, actually very funny one. I stop at the traffic light. Then I see my mirror got behind all those like smaller bike 2B. I think they know you know when you ride smaller bike, people tend to kacau you. You ride small, then they ride beside you, then they rev, then they boom. But somehow when I ride this, I think they don't dare to kacau this bike.
In general.
So you just go behind,
They go behind, then they look, then they see, then they... Ghost got one bike tried to kacau before. I think I never play him lah. I just open a bit then I overtake. I already disappear. Then you know, better don't play lah. So this bike is actually quite deceptively fast. So the road presence and when you travel right, people see you from behind. They also go one side because they scared you ram them actually is they fall not you fall because you're like almost like a tank. So for people who want to experience like what I said earlier, once in a lifetime experience, ride a class 2 bike, but yet don't ride those kind of sport bike. If you are not the kind of sport bike, like aggressive riding, you want a more chillax, but yet you don't want to cut out people one, this is the bike that because maintenance wise it's really very very don't have chain maintenance, very easy lah, and don't cost a lot.
Anybody who wants to consider a class 2 bike definitely must consider the cost of owning it. When there's assurance that okay, this bike doesn't really cost a bomb to maintain, that would be good.
In fact, actually I spend more money on my Super 4 maintenance so than this. So a lot of people always got think that like Super 4 class 2A like 2A bike mah, but actually Super 4 the maintenance cost is a class 2 maintenance cost.
I understand. Yeah. Super 4 is all old technology lah.
Yeah, it's because of old technology then. So actually a lot of people they never maintain the Super 4 good enough lah. They abuse the bike a lot. That's why got problem. This bike you see already very sayang you also don't want to abuse.
Correct. Yeah. I understand. Tony, thank you so much for sharing
no problem, man.
Your FJR with us.
Very happy.
I think it's rarely seen. Not really seen.
And then some more we have a lot of requests for this bike, so finally we have an owner who actually share his experience, his knowledge about this bike. It's good enough, sir.
Well versed as well.
So, as a token of appreciation, we would like to present our friend here some stickers from our sponsors, Liqui Moly. Yeah, right. You support us, huh, Liqui Moly.
That's it for the vlog. Any riders want to review their bike, us, you can touch us on our social media pages below.
FJR riders out there, if you have anything else to comment to add on to this,
review,
right? Just put in the comment section below. Click, click like and share this.
Like and share this video.
I don't know. Maybe because I have. I'm having a headache actually. Okay. Like and share this video with your riding kakis, and don't forget to subscribe. And also do support us as well as our awesome sponsor,
Liqui Moly.
Right, Liqui Moly. Yeah. Check out their online store with for a whole range of Moro Care products, and click on our link to get discounts.
And yeah, that's it for the vlog. We'll see you in the next one.